In wildlife photography, nothing scripted.
It's an iconic image went viral all over the world.
Expect the unexpected.
Hi, I'm Sudhir Shivaram and I'm a wildlife photographer. My passion is traveling to new places, to explore new terrains, and to capture images of different wildlife species. And so, I have a trip planned to Valparai in the Annamalai Tiger Reserve in Tamil Nadu. And I'm hoping to get some shots of the elusive lion-tailed macaque, which is endemic to that region.
Photography started way back during my college days when I studied in the Malnad College of Engineering. There, we regularly used to go for trekking, and that is where my love for nature also came into picture. And then we also had a photography club in our college, and my love for photography started. So, like a lot of other folks, I also became a software engineer, was there for almost 18 years in the corporate world. And in fact, in parallel to this, I was doing my photography journey, photography teaching. So I was a mentor for wildlife photography as well. So both of this went hand in hand in parallel. And at one point of time, I realized that I'm not doing justice to either of the role. My wife stepped in and she said, "I see your passion, love for photography teaching for wildlife. So why don't you get into that as a full-time profession?" So I have read a lot about Valparai and the lion-tailed macaques. And this is going to be my first encounter with the lion-tailed macaque, in case if I'm able to see them.
I'm all packed up and heading to Coimbatore, from where I will drive to Valparai.
I took my morning flight from Bangalore to Coimbatore, landed in Coimbatore, completely charged.
I drive through the city of Coimbatore and then I hit the highway.
And then coconut trees, the signature of being South India. So that was a beautiful scene. Enjoyed the drive through that. Best part of any of these kind of expeditions for me is like I love driving. I mean, I'm never a passenger seat person.
So far, there isn't too much traffic and the drive is pretty smooth. At the Aliya Reservoir, I get a tantalizing first glimpse of the Ghats. I have heard that there are over 30 endemic fish species in these waters.
When I started driving up, I saw the board. It said like there are 40 hairpin bends. And it's been a long time since I drove in some of these kind of hairpin bends. On the web, I had read that hairpin bend number 9 has the most scenic view over there.
As I turn at the hairpin, all of a sudden I spot the Nilgiri Thar, an endangered goat species only found in the Western Ghats. I even see a mother and child interact, quite magical. I manage to whip out my camera and take a couple of pictures. A good start to my trip. Hope my luck holds out. Finally nearing Valparai. This area is full of tea and coffee estates. But around these estates are about 40 fragments of rainforest. This place seems to be a biodiversity hotspot.
As a part of this expedition, I hope to learn more about the species. I hope to understand them better in terms of the various issues they are facing, the conflict, the man-animal conflict over there, so that I can see as a wildlife photographer how I can help conserve these species in a much better way.
I love the start of any of my expeditions. Never know what lies ahead. Could get some great images, could also get nothing at all. Let's see how it goes. Break of dawn. A new day filled with new possibilities of exploring this area. I'm going to try to shoot images of the local fauna and hopefully I'll spot the lion-tailed macaque today. Wildlife photography is a lot about the unending wait for the right image.
95-96 is when I got into wildlife photography, and for 10 years I had not seen a tiger in the wild. And finally I got this particular shot of the two tigers watching a goat. It's an iconic image. This one went viral all over the world. Another turning point for me is this other very iconic image of mine of the leopard sleeping on the tree, photographed at Kabini. So this won me the Sanctuary Asia Wildlife Photographer of the Year award, and this was one of the most turning points of my life for me to switch over from the corporate world to this wildlife world. I'll be meeting my good old friend Prakash, who is also a wildlife photographer, and I'm looking forward to shooting the lion-tailed macaques and a lot of other species of Valparai with him.
We meet up in one corner of the plantation. As we look for the elusive macaques, the mist settles in.
So generally this season, the ficus trees fruit in the slopes.
Okay.
So great hornbills come in large numbers to feed on this. I can hear a sound.
You can hear it.
Yeah, it's still flying.
Nice. So today morning during our walk, we came across the great Indian hornbill flying. We could hear the sound, but we did not see it.
Which is not surprising. The wing beat of the great hornbill can be heard from more than half a mile away. So could have been quite far off.
What about elephants?
The elephants you will get during the season, they cross over in large numbers, cross this estate and go. So this is a migration season from October to March. Yeah. You will get elephants. You'll get sambar deer.
So you mentioned about sambar deer. Then early in the morning, I could hear a lot of alarm calls. So which obviously means here there are some predators. I mean, I know.
Yeah,
this is a leopard country.
You will get leopards also here. And LTMs, of course, iconic species of Valparai.
Do you think LTMs will come, the lion-tailed macaque?
They'll
come to this altitude?
Yeah, they come.
Wow. Wow. What's that moving there?
Yeah, it's the Nilgiri langur.
Oh.
The Nilgiri langur is rather shy. So it's great we caught a glimpse of this primate.
And beautiful. Also if you look at the landscape it's a good
one. You can
one.
Take some so couple of shots.
Even with the long telly at 200 millimeter, I think we should get a nice shot.
In here a sound. Malabar giant squirrel.
The Malabar squirrel is a large squirrel that hardly leaves the trees. They leap from branch to branch using their tail as stabilizers.
So during jackfruit season, you will get Malabar squirrel and lion-tailed macaque interacting. That's the same tree, right? Yeah, yeah.
So Prakash and myself heard of gaur in a particular location, and we went in search of that.
The drive to the location where I've heard the gaurs are is completely rough and rocky. I think we are going to be tossed about a bit.
So,
That was some off-roading.
Yeah, it's
so
brilliant.
Very bumpy road. And I think this car did really well. Great off-roading experience.
I heard, got information that Gars are somewhere here.
Somewhere, wait, down the valley over there?
Down the valley. So they usually come up to feed on this coffee plantation where you have enough grazing grass. Any food.
Just fold it.
The gaur is the world's largest living bovine. It's a vulnerable animal with a dwindling population.
If we get the gaurs, we'll definitely get lucky with that.
We wait for quite a while, but don't manage to catch the gaur. The herd has clearly moved on.
In wildlife photography, nothing's scripted. We have to go with the flow. We have to go and wait and see, like, whatever we get, we just shoot. And sometimes we wait for the whole day and nothing happens.
It's a lovely, peaceful walk back to my room. But I first head to a spot where I'm told there is an Indian scopsol roosting. I'm keen to get a closer look.
We have the Indian scopsol here, and generally they roost high up in these kind of tree burrows. So what we do is, like, to study their behavior, or even from a photography point of view, we construct this artificial machans so that we get the eye level shots.
The Indian scopsol is a nocturnal bird, so it's quite difficult to spot in daytime, especially as its coloring camouflages it so effectively. Moments like these are what a photographer waits for. I hope I'm as lucky tomorrow with the lion-tailed macaw. It's my last day in Valparai, and I'm really hoping to sight and get some images of the elusive LTN.
When it comes to wildlife photography, I strongly believe in what I call as the subject knowledge. If you want to be a better wildlife photographer, subject knowledge or understanding about the animal behavioral aspect is the key.
And so I have fixed to meet Ashni Dhawale, a young PhD student working on these primates.
Tell me a little bit about the LTMs itself, the lion-tailed macaques.
So the lion-tailed macaque is a species which is endemic to the Western Ghats. So it's not found anywhere else in the world.
Okay.
It's an endangered species.
What's their count? Like, how many of them are left in the wild?
So there's less than 3,500 individuals left in the wild.
Okay.
So in the wild, they occur in family groups of about 19 to 26 individuals on average.
Okay.
And they're thought to be the only truly arboreal macaque species, which means that they spend more than 99% of their time on the tree canopies.
But here I've heard, like, you find them all over the ground everywhere. So what's so special about Valparai and the lion-tailed macaques here?
The 160 odd lion-tailed macaques that live in this particular forest fragment have to share the space with more than 87 households.
Okay.
So there's quite a lot of human interaction as
Okay. We have been talking about the lion-tailed macaques for a long time. I'm all set here to capture them. Like,
yes.
I mean, how do we find them?
Sure. Yeah. So we're just going to walk around a little bit, look up into the canopy, look for any movement. But you'll be able to see them. They're black and they're in groups, so you can spot them easily. We'll just walk around a bit and look around in the canopies.
And as we were walking, suddenly there were a number of them right on the path.
What I understand about the lion-tailed macaques, like, they're very shy, they always stay right up in the trees. But here at Valparai, it's totally different. Something totally unique and very specific to this area. We see them walking around and it's just like hardly a few feet away from me. They're so friendly, they're not afraid of the humans. So it's probably more to do with the humans feeding them quite often and they getting so close to us.
This proximity with humans is a change in the animals' behavior, and it can potentially put them in harm's way. It's far from an ideal thing to have happened.
So here we're seeing the big troop. It's actually moved from a small bit of forest on the other side across the road into this human settlement where they have raided for some food. You can still see some of them on the rooftops. And now they're sort of moving this way and hopefully into the forest this direction. So we can sort of just follow the troop as they come. We'll see more individuals emerging from there soon.
So is this very common where they raid the house? Like, what do they look for in these houses?
Yeah, so the houses actually have many open garbage pits. So it's really quick access for lion-tailed macaques to get their food from.
And what is their actual diet like? What do they feed on?
So they're primarily frugivorous, which means that they feed on mostly rainforest fruit species.
And also we saw a few young ones over here. So generally, like, how long do they stay with the parents?
So the young ones can actually stay with the parents up to 3 years.
3 years?
Mother will be lactating for about a year, which is extremely long. You also see older individuals sleeping with the mother, moving around with the mother. So they spend a lot of time with their parents.
Enough with the talking. I should take a few photographs quickly in case these macaques decide to move on. I like going in close to focus on their expression, their interactions.
Remember another thing, where I was trying to photograph the lion-tailed macaque right looking at me, and two of them, or probably one of them, just walked behind me. I didn't even notice. Like, I saw, I could feel something going behind me, and then, like, with the causer of that, when you saw, like, it was just walking past me. I mean, like, this is something totally different personally for me. And it was more of like being part of the troop, like staying with them, more than photography, like I enjoyed being with them, and they, the way they accepted me and let me be close to them, that was a fascinating experience.
Having taken my fill of photographs, I head off. But the macaques don't seem to be done with me yet. My plan in Valparaiso was to get up close with the LTM, but I didn't expect that they would actually sit on my car and make eye contact with me. It's fascinating to see how these animals, usually so reclusive, completely arboreal, have adapted to living with people, interacting with them without fear. And I'm so glad that people here also respect these animals and let them flourish. Like making these bridges for them to cross the road safely by valuing their lives. That's the only way humans and wildlife can live together side by side. And then on my drive back, I spot something in the tea plantation and get out. It's a herd of gaur. I had quite given up on spotting them. Here's my chance to take some nice pictures. The male gaur are mammoth, about 7 feet in height. Each herd is usually headed by a dominant bull with around 5 to 20 members following.
Full day we've been walking around looking for them, we couldn't find. And now, driving towards the sunset point, we just come across it. This is fantastic, and this is what wildlife is all about. Expect the unexpected.
It's end of day, and I settle down to go through my photographs, select and edit them.
When it comes to my images, I'm very specific about what kind of images I choose. For me, it's those storytelling images, capturing those candid moments. Of course, the basic fundamentals of photography about exposure sharpness, those things put aside. For me, I want to convey about the species, the location, what I felt, what I saw. That is what I want my viewers to see, with a little bit of corrections to bring up the overall appeal in the images and present it to the viewers.
Last few days I've been out here in Valparai exploring this place and coming face to face with the lion-tailed macaques, my first time ever. And then I've gone through all the various images I've shot in the last few days. And like, they're beautiful. I'm so happy about it. And above all, for me, it's just not about the images. For me, it's being out here in the wild, among the wildlife, hearing to the sound of the birds, the river flowing, the sound. This is what life for me is. And for me, the journey continues, and being one with nature is what I love to do.